Chapter 25 of a book titled Adventures of a Dutch Fish Farmer in Nigeria. Recording by Dominic, Iyodo. Willy had to rush to Nigeria after the sudden death of his business partner, Ade Alakija. He resumes work as interim manager of the company Durante Fish Industries while living in the house of Ade's father, Ogie. Chapter 25. Take me down to the river. Eventually, I wanted to do something different instead of going straight to my room at Ogie's house after work. I didn't really have any friend to go to. And for Ade's friends, it was back to life as usual. They didn't contact me anymore. Also, the expat community in Ibadan is mainly Lebanese and Indian. They are closed communities. I didn't fit in, but to be honest, I didn't try to either. I prefer to deal with Nigerians. But because I had more money than the average Nigerian, to develop true friendships was hard. What to do? I sent my canoes from Holland to Nigeria in one of the containers I exported from the Netherlands to Durante Farm. I placed them on the bank of a Lele, a small dam close to Ibadan on the road to Arua, only 30 minutes away from Ogie's house. I knew a guy who lived on the shore of the dam. He called himself a bone specialist and jungle soldier, but most people know him as Papa Blessing. He took care of my canoes. Anytime I went there, he would help me to get one of the canoes into the water, and off I go on my own to the source of the dam on the other side of the lake, just a couple of miles ahead. Arrived there, I heard noises of the city as one low sound. Single sounds were not recognizable anymore. The noise sounded like a giant roaring lion, but non-stop. I opened my beer and started staring at some wooden canoes where fishermen were lowering their gill nets. Just before it got too dark to see a thing, and we're forced to stop. Birds were also in a hurry to find shelter for the night to come. In particular, the cattle egret. White birds which look like an ibis. The shore of the dam was covered with big overhanging trees, competing for the sunlight. Some had been overdoing it and had fallen into the water because of their weight. Being at the lake always refreshed me, and my stressed body welcomed the exercise. On my way back to the shore, almost dark, I could smell the food being cooked on simple wooden fires, while children were playing and still having fun in the water. Occasionally, I smelled the scent of pot, which reminded me of my early days as a student at Wageningen University. During these canoe trips, I really felt fulfilled, not missing anything or anyone. Also, my outings to visit Ogie, the manager of Oyo Fish Farm, were pleasant. I went there almost on a weekly basis. From Ibadan, the farm was located about an hour and a half drive to the north, close to Oyo town. The farm was well managed and looked well maintained. Going through the books didn't take much time. When I was there, I always went to the Ogun River on the way to Esheyin. Ogun State was named after this river. The bad road crossed the river and the bridge was in a deplorable state. Deadly accidents were common. On the riverbank beside the bridge, there was one very big tree strangled with creepers. In a way, the tree and the creepers had a sustainable relationship because both were still flourishing. Sometimes I met the tree covered with white cloth, a sign that this giant tree was worshipped by the nearby villagers. In the dry season, the water was clear. One type of fish was dominant, living in schools and preying on anything that moves. I always loved to fish a couple of hours before I returned to Ibadan. One day, enjoying the peace of a Laili dam again, I wondered what would happen if I went downstream all the way back to Abeokuta by Kano. The river would finally end up in the lagoon of Lagos, I reasoned. I let the idea be for a while, but after a couple of weeks, I asked myself when I was going to do it. I challenged myself by asking if I was afraid. So, I decided to do a little test with Papa Blessing, the jungle soldier, in my two-seater canoe. We went upstream for about 1 kilometer and back. The river was quiet. It was beautiful. The river is crossed by a dam upstream and flows through the old Oyo National Park. I believed it would be a very pleasing journey to go downstream through an area of Oyo State, which is not densely populated. I left my canoe at the fish farm in Oyo and planned the journey for the following weekend. I told my daughter about it, and she wasn't surprised. She reminded me that I have always had an obsession about going downstream on the river, because when we were together, I always tell her, "Breche, how would it be to go down on this river? Papa, you know this song which actually carries the lyrics about boating on a river from the stags in a way you feel?" "No, I don't know the song, but I would love to know it." The lyrics is strikingly expressing my feelings, and I loaded it on my computer. A beautiful song indeed.
As I gaze in the water, she eases me down, touching me gently with the waters that flow past my boat on the river, so I don't cry out anymore.
On Friday, very early in the morning, I left the farm in Ibadan. On my way, I met a security guy with a small snake bite on his foot. "Do you know what type of snake has bitten you?" I asked.
"It was still dark, but I believe it's a black mamba," he replied.
He didn't wear any boots, but I didn't want to teach him a lesson about it. I saw that it was already too late. He looked still sort of okay. When I went to do my round at the farm and came back, his condition had changed dramatically. The guy was in agony. So I rushed him to the hospital. He survived. But it made me wonder who was going to take me to the hospital if I was bitten by a snake on my canoe trip. There are no roads, only the bush and rivers and streams. Papa Blessing and I expected the journey would take at least one night. I also bought wine and gin apart from bread, canned fish, peanuts, and other things which are easy to carry and don't need any preparation. All the food and drinks were put in a watertight barrel. I put my phones and money in a plastic bag, which I kept on my body. Some people at our farm told me I was mad to start such a journey. Ezekiel told me,
"Oga, you want to die on the water? But you haven't made me rich yet. Make people rich before you start such a journey. It is not fair. We blacks are not stupid. We don't go for such a risk-taking adventure. And for what?"
Papa Blessing wanted to accompany me. But the money I promised him at the end of the journey was most likely his biggest motivation. We also took two cutlasses, because you never knew if you would have to leave the canoe and cut yourself through the bush to find a way out. No life jackets, no tents for the night. We would sleep under the stars. We arrived at the river at 11 o'clock in the morning. Before entering the water, Papa Blessing blessed the river by spraying a little gin in it.
"Really?"
After he took a generous sip of the gin.
"The river will be our friend. And all those mummy water, no go allow us."
And we took off on a journey I will never forget in my life. We paddled slowly, as there was no need to hurry. The current was our friend. Also, our boat trip was not about time. We didn't even know how long the journey would take, because the road map didn't show anything about the line of the river. It only showed that the next road that crossed the river was about 15 miles away as a crow flies. The sun was shining brightly. My face cap was very useful. Papa Blessing was paddling in the back. I was paddling in the front. Each took one side. It went very well. After 20 to 30 minutes, we heard some sort of sounds in front of us. "Is there a road ahead?" I wondered. When a car passes a bridge, you get some rumbles and then the sound disappears again. But now the rumbling was increasing every minute we paddled further. I had to conclude that the sound could be water splashing on rocks. In other words, rapids ahead. Fortunately, the rapids were not too serious. We had enough space between the rocks to maneuver. It even speeded up our journey. After those rapids, the water became quiet again, and I understood for the first time the meaning of the saying, "Still waters run deep." The trees along the riverbank became bigger and bigger. As I already suspected, there were hardly any human beings to be seen. In the high trees, we had a lot of monkeys. If I looked hard, I could see a glimpse of them. They were very shy. That is not so surprising, since I saw plenty monkey heads and limbs at the juju market in Ibadan. We continued our journey, which was getting more and more exciting because of the increasing turmoil of the rapids in front of us. Eventually, we had to lift the canoe out of the water to bypass a waterfall, which according to us, could end our journey too early. It took us over an hour just to bypass it. We had to walk our way through the abundant vegetation. Also, the snake bite of this morning crossed my mind. We changed our positions in the canoe. I let the jungle soldiers wisely sit in front. No sign of human beings at all, which is an amazing experience in the most populated country of Africa. In front of any serious rapids, the soldier and I made little plans for how to go around them. It turned out that the risk taker was actually me. I was in a phase of my life where it didn't matter anymore. In a way, the guys at the fish farm were right. I was risking my life in this jungle. To work your way through the jungle is not pleasant, and it is time consuming. Whereas a ride through the white foaming water with some bumps takes only 20 seconds. I have canoed through rapids before, but just in the Belgian Ardennes during the summer when rivers flow quietly. This time, we even had to walk beside our canoe in many cases. Otherwise, we got stuck on the rocks. Then the canoe hit a rock at the front. I was launched out of it and hit my back on the rock before I fell into the turbulent water. I made myself as small as possible and held my arms over my head for protection. The rapidly flowing water pushed me forward for a little while before I could raise my head out of the water. Jungle soldier looked at me quite worried. Still steadying the boat, his remark was as dry as the water was wet.
"You are a good swimmer."
I climbed into the boat and we continued without talking again. I realized that if something happened to me, the soldier would have a big problem when he arrives without me in Ibadan, and everybody will be looking for me. The river was curving all the time. What looked like a small distance on the map was actually a long journey. We only saw a few settlements on the riverside. The people were shy, and the children even looked afraid, seeing a white man for the first time in their lives. It is not possible to sail the river with a wooden canoe. Most likely, they had never seen a plastic canoe before as well. When we asked them how far to the road that crosses the river, their answers were not clear at all. On some occasions, they said it was not possible to reach the road by boat. The environment was still enchanting. I never imagined Nigeria could be so beautiful and pure. No waste, no sign of human interference. Just me and my soldier in the canoe and nature all around us. Time was passing, though we had to seek a place to stay the night. When it gets dark in Nigeria, it happens within 30 minutes, so there is no time to waste. When we saw a big rock in the middle of a wide part of the river, we took our chances. We pulled our canoe onto the relatively flat rock and stayed the night on top of the rock. We ate a little bit and drank some more. while we listened to the jungle noise, which was actually very loud but not disturbing. After a little freshening up in the river, I went to bed on the rock, looking at the stars. It reminded me of the Lee Marvin song, "I Was Born Under a Wandering Star." The rock had been beaten by the sun all day. It was nicely warm. In the middle of the night, the rock was cooled down. The cold woke me up. But I was still comfortable knowing that we would soon see daybreak and the sun would warm us up again. We left the rock early in the morning, after I had tried to call my driver, but there was no network. I turned the phone off again to save my battery. Today we hoped to see the main road, which crosses the river not far from the little town of Erua. Once we had reached the bridge, we would go to the town by Okada and find the network to call my driver to pick us up. Nature was pure, beautiful. I was amazed by the trees. On the older branches and in the canopies, epiphytes were growing. I saw ferns and bromeliads. I believe I recognized some of them from the living room in my parents' house when I was very young. The vegetation under the trees was abundant. The leaves were mainly very big and organized in such a way that they were able to catch the little bit of sunlight which passed through the branches of the trees. I noticed that when the river current was rapid, the horizon of the water came very close. You were not able to see far ahead. Soldier wasn't a talker, and I was happy with that. After every river bend, we hoped to see the bridge or hear the typical noise of a car crossing the bridge. It finally happened at 4 p.m. We were able to put our canoe on top of the car before the darkness fell at 6 p.m. and we left for home. Papa Blessing was happy that we made it, and I was happy that I finally did it. As I have already told you, all new things are scary in the beginning, but after some time, you'll start to like them. Within a few weeks' time, I wanted to do it again. This time, from the location where we finished our first journey to Abeokuta, or to the Oyan Dam. The map was not clear about that. The rainy season was about to finish, with only an occasional rain shower. We didn't change the format. Papa Blessing in the back and I in the front of the canoe. The first day of the journey went well. When we reached a bridge, which was not on the map, we noticed a small community. They hospitably invited us to stay with them, and we were able to sleep in one of the huts under a mosquito netting. I exchanged some food with the community members, while Papa Blessing had some conversations with the elders, feeling very important to be my guide. During the night, a violent thunderstorm erupted. It lasted 4 hours. The rain was so heavy, it was as if the weather gods were fighting about whether the rain should stop or not. The gods in favor of rain won, with the outcome that the rainy season wasn't yet over. In the early morning, some guys of the community carried our canoe to the river. But when I saw the river, I was amazed and became a bit nervous. I looked at Papa Blessing to see how he would react to it. He only said in a dry way,
"This is not the same river anymore. This is the highway."
The water had risen more than 2 meters and the current speed had tripled. "Papa Blessing, we have to bless the water," I said. He was already on his way to my barrel to take out the gin. This time around, he took the blessing of the river very seriously, which meant more gin for the river and more gin for himself. "Please, Papa Blessing, I also need some support. Hand over the bottle." I took a very big sip too. It was not an option to stay or cancel the trip. We had to go. Without any discussion, we took off and tried to control the highway. Most of the rocks had disappeared under the water. Occasionally, we saw signs of the rocks as little patches of white foaming water. The tour wasn't a touristic tour anymore. This was about survival. On many occasions, we followed the more gently flowing areas at the side of the river to stay out of the intense and turbulent flow in the middle. As a result, my body was scratched all over by the overhanging trees. When we arrived at a bridge close to Abiokuta, I was just relieved we made it. I wasn't happy at all that I had done it. In two journeys, we had seen snakes, lizards, different types of monkeys, and many beautiful birds, but not any crocodiles. I asked Papa Blessing, "At which river would we see crocodiles?" Because I wanted to paddle in a crocodile river before I moved back to the Netherlands in December.
"Now, sure river, and we go start from Ijebode, and we go finish for the lagoon, when the Lagos State,"
he replied. The Osun River turned out to be very quiet, and it had a completely different appearance to the Ogun River. No rocks, a sandy bottom, and a lot of water hyacinth blocking some of the waterways. After a while, we passed about 3 kilometers with only dead fish. Most likely, they had been poisoned by a fisherman with gamelin 20. This chemical is used as an insecticide and is very toxic for fish. It destroys the entire water fauna too. Many communities were living at the riverside. Some had houses on wooden pillars. The surroundings were nice, but the river didn't have the serene appearance I was used to from the Ogun River. The communities were much more used to city life, living close to the metropolis of Lagos. We didn't see any crocodiles during the 2 days, but it wasn't a disappointment to me. I enjoyed the tour, with a highlight at the end when we entered the massive lagoon near Lagos. From the lagoon, we had to paddle for a couple of hours to enter the fish market at Ekpe. The lagoon water is brackish. There is a lot of small sandbar between the lagoon and the Atlantic Ocean. Because the lagoon is rich in nutrients, nature's production is high, including the stocks of fish. The fish market at Ekpe reflects the lagoon's fish population, which is impressive. The market itself is very dirty and smelly, but you see fish species you've never seen before, even still alive, such as the electric catfish. when we pulled out our canoe onto the river shore. The fishermen and market women looked surprised.
Where have you come from?
They asked. When we told them that we came from Ijebode, they could hardly believe it and showed us respect.
Please, white man, come and sit down. You need water?
When Taji, my driver, came to pick us up, a woman helped us to pack the canoe on top of our car. I just enjoyed the scene and relaxed a little bit before we went back to Ibadan.